Thank you, Aditya. Honorable Union Minister Shri Ravi Shankar Prasad ji, Shri Ramadu ji, our advisor to the Lieutenant Governor, Shri Farooq Khan Saab, Shorya Doval ji, distinguished co-panelists, and our moderator, Mr. Aditya Raj Kohl. Thank you. I believe this is a great opportunity to have an exchange of ideas objectively, unabashedly. I will speak from the heart because I believe that the beauty of this conclave is an idea of different myriad expressions and exchanges, and that is the beauty of our country. A lot of contrarian views can exist if they coexist peacefully, that is. And from the confluence of those differing views, the beauty of the idea of India rises. I am a 34-year-old Kashmiri Muslim, a part of the Indian mainstream, who was a part of the Indian mainstream before 5th of August, is still a part of the mainstream, and will always remain a part of the mainstream. Despite any objections, ideological or otherwise, I might not agree with Mr. Kohl when he says that all of us agree that the abrogation of Article 370 or the devolution of a state into a union territory is something we all agree with. I will stick my neck out and probably be the only one who says that I personally do not agree with that. But that doesn't take away my Indianness from me. I do not believe that any population in this country has sacrificed more for the idea of India than Kashmiri Muslims have. And the tragedy of our narrative is that we seldom speak about Kashmiri Muslims when we talk about sacrifices. Out of the 40 to 50,000 civilian and non-civilian lives that we've lost in Kashmir, nearly 18 to 20,000 have been Kashmiri Muslims killed by militants. Out of the 2,500 J&K policemen who have laid down their lives for this country, 2,200 are Kashmiri Muslims. Their children today are part of the same police force, bringing justice to the martyrs who have laid down their lives for this country. And we never or seldom speak about what Kashmiri Muslims have done for this country. And I think that needs to change. While the topic at hand is about a way forward, most of us have, and I think because of the nature of the topic, we'll continue to talk about the past. I will briefly talk about the past, but I promise to speak about the future as well. Article 370 has been abrogated. The erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir has been stripped of its statehood, a federal mechanism, into two union territories. That is a reality. We might agree or disagree with it. The narrative and the arguments that support or oppose Article 370 abrogation are different. I stand on one side, different people stand on the other side. When we say that the traditional mainstream exploited Article 370, believe it if it's coming from me. You know, Shri Ramadavji will agree with me. When I became the mayor of Srinagar, this was the first time that the traditional mainstream had lost the capital city of Jammu and Kashmir, and any party other than the National Conference had captured Srinagar. And I won that election. The parties did not boycott that election. I won that election against a combined candidate of National Conference, PDP, and Congress. The three parties polled 26 wards. I polled 44 wards. So I am not coming from the other side. I am coming from the challenging side. I am a young man who believes that the traditional mainstream has exploited, blackmailed the successive governments. I believe that they have taken they've hid behind the fig leaf of their perceived patriotism to hide their corruption. And I believe that is still happening now, not through the politicians, but through our bureaucracy. We had the same bureaucracy before the 5th of August. We have the same bureaucracy now. It is the same bureaucracy that served the two traditional families, and it will continue to serve anybody who is in power, not out of conviction. I believe that maladministration, lack of development in Kashmir is also to be attributed to the way our bureaucracy has been given a very long rope, quote unquote, in national interest. When we talk about old Kashmir, it is important to talk about the sacrifices of Kashmiris, first and foremost. You know, I have said this at a lot of places, that when politicians, I disagree with them. As I said, I rose as a challenger to them. I was a mayor who wrested Srinagar from National Conference and PDP after 70 years. But I also know that a former MLA belonging to PDP, I think, was lodged for 6 or 7 months in a sub-jail, whose two brothers were killed by militants, whose father was assassinated by militants. If you tell me that any of us speaking here or going on TV channels and screaming or yelling, there can be a bigger Indian patriot than a guy who has given two brothers and a father for this country, I would highly disagree. We might come from different ideological scapes and convictions, but I, as a proud young Indian, believe that we have to engage with the common man on the street, irrespective of his ideological moorings, as long as he believes in the idea of India. I believe that the future of Jammu and Kashmir, and I believe the future of Ladakh, lies in harmonious, progressive, liberal coexistence within the idea of India. Our interpretations of the idea of India might be different, but it's a big, beautiful country with a deep, deep, rich culture and legacy of coexistence. When I went to boarding school in Shimla, I remember, a lot of people in my boarding school in Shimla were Punjabis. And, especially at that age, Punjabis aren't very fond of contrarian views. But I still stuck my neck out. And I continue to do that today. I believe that we have sold the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A in various ways. One, that there was lack of development, there'll be development now. Have we seen that happening? Are we taking adequate measures for that to happen? I believe we aren't. Second, corruption. Again, I'll stick my neck out. If you take the 10 richest politicians in Kashmir and club their property and empires, and then you club the property and empires of the 10 richest bureaucrats in Kashmir, the 10 richest bureaucrats will outweigh and outvalue the 10 richest politicians in Kashmir by a measure of 100. But we believe, and we are told by these bureaucrats, that we are the only Indians in Kashmir. Tolerate our corruption, honor our corruption, because we integrate Kashmir with India. Is that not the same thing that the traditional mainstream told us? I spoke at the Republic Conclave, I believe, last year, and this was before the 5th of August, and I told them that when Dr. Farooq Abdullah comes and shares a common political party stage with Mamata Banerjee in West Bengal or somebody else in some other state of the country, has a rose in his sherwani, and he says, Bharat Mata Ki Jai and Jai Hind. I think people really actually believe that. But 2 days later, the same Dr. Farooq Abdullah goes to Tangdar and tells a confluence of people there that par dekho kitni achhi sadke hain, par dekho kitni development hai, humse shayad 47 mein galti ho gayi. And 2 days later, he'll again come and give an impassioned speech in Delhi. I think the politicians of our generation have to change that. We have to say in closed doors in Kashmir what we have the courage to say here. We have to say in Kashmir what we have the courage to say here. And the first and foremost thing is, yes, we are Indians. We might disagree. We might engage. We might have different interpretations of the idea of India, but we are Kashmiris. That is where the way ahead lies. That is where the evolution of the mainstream has to come from. We cannot synthetically substitute the entire mainstream lock, stock, and barrel and say that we are going to substitute the mainstream, we are going to create an arrangement. The mainstream, as imperfect as it was, will evolve out of its own ashes, organically. I am a very small, humble part, a spark of that evolution. Nobody believed that we could win. And again, Ram Madhav ji will agree with me. That was a David versus Goliath moment when National Conference lost Srinagar. And I believe we all need to reach out to Kashmiris. When Aditya introduced himself, he said that, I am a Kashmiri Pandit. He's a very dear friend of mine. I would like him to say that he's a Kashmiri. Like we say, I'm an Indian. Is it acceptable for anybody if I introduce myself on a panel that I'm an Indian Muslim? I'm an Indian Hindu? I'm an Indian. That is the first foremost identity that is cohesive for all of us. And that is where the way forward lies. The way forward lies in starting a political process in Kashmir. Distinguished gentlemen and ladies, the way forward lies in accepting that the beauty of this country is accepting different contrarian views, having space for it. And I urge everybody at this gathering to understand and respect the sacrifices the people of Kashmir have rendered by being a part of this country. Despite being a Muslim majority state, being a part of this country. Don't use what Umar Abdullah or Mehbooba Mufti say in election rallies to judge the Muslims of Kashmir. The Muslims of Kashmir are as Indians as people in Maharashtra, people in Gujarat, or people in any other state of this country. And it is time that they get their due. And their due will be accountability, progress, liberalism, peace, and first and foremost, a space of dignity where we accept them as equal Indians and stop asking certificates of patriotism and nationalism from them. Thank you.